Welcome back, friends. In this video, we are going to cover some assertion framework. What is assertion framework? Using assertion framework, we can check our test cases expected value with actual values. We can check our test cases expected value with the actual values. That is the usage of assertion framework. In the last video itself, we used JUnit assertion framework. JUnit having its own assertion APIs. Using that assertion APIs, we have verified our expected value with the actual values. See here, this is our test cases which we written in the part of last video. Here we are using assertion.assert equals assertions.assert not equal, right? So these APIs are coming from org.junit jupyter.api assertion. JUnit 5 will have one package called new package called Jupyter. If you say Jupyter, it's a JUnit 5. Okay, now this assertion is coming from JUnit 5. Yeah, this assertion APIs are coming from JUnit 5. We are using that assertion API to test our expected value with the actual values. In this video, we'll going to cover some third party assertion framework. We'll going to see that. Okay. So before going to that, I want to tell one thing. I never explained in the past two videos how this attest annotation and assertion APIs, how it's available here, how we are able to access these APIs. Generally, if you want to access any APIs, we need to add some artifact, right? Starter pattern. Through the starter pattern, we are able to access particular API. For example, let's say I want to work with JPA data, we need to add JPA starter project. Through that, we are able to access JPA libraries. But here, I have not added any API, but I am able to access JUnit APIs, right? How it is possible? When you look at pom.xml file, you can see there is a one dependency called Spring Boot starter test. Whenever you create any Spring Boot project, that Spring Boot project come with part of testing framework. You don't have to add the dependency manually. It will come automatically while creating a project. Okay. When you go inside that, it will navigate to one more started project. Sorry, one more pom.xml file where you can see org.junit.jupyter. JUnit Jupyter. JUnit Jupyter nothing but it's a JUnit 5. So JUnit 5 coming part of this particular artifact. So now in this video, we'll going to cover some more assertion framework, right? For those assertion framework, we don't have to write, we don't have to add any additional artifact. This artifact is enough. This artifact provide those assertion framework to us. For example, see here, JSON assert. JSON assert is one of the assertion framework. Using this library, we can test our JSON files. Whenever you get any response from your REST API, I want to verify that JSON response. In such a case, we can use this JSON assert as well as there is one more assertion framework available. Yeah, assert J. Yeah, JSON path and JSON assert. These two dependency for asserting your JSON response, which is coming from REST web API. Okay, we can use this framework. Apart from these two, there is a assert J. Assert J also one of the assertion framework like JUnit assert. Using this also, we can assert our expected value with the actual values. There is another framework called Hamcrest. Using this assert library, we can check our expected value with actual values. That is very similar to assert J and JUnit assert APIs. Okay. Now we're going to see Hamcrest, then assert J, JSON assert and JSON path. This assertion framework we're going to see now. I'll going to provide some examples. These frameworks are very easy one. Okay, very easy one. Those are self-explanatory. Whatever API they are providing, by reading that API, you can understand that what this particular assert method will do. Easily you can understand. I'll going to provide some few examples. Through that, you can improve by yourself. Okay. First, we're going to see Hamcrest. Let me close all Hamcrest. This is the Hamcrest test case method, test case class. Here I have a four test method and one init method, that init method annotated with before each. And before each, we'll talk about later this. Okay. There is a first test method, list test. I want to test the list data, whatever data available inside array list, I want to test that. Okay. Here, array list, data list equal to array field ascii, I'm saying Suresh, Kesav and Ravi. Then number data, it's a 1, 3, 4, 8, that's it. The assert that is coming from Hamcrest framework. See here, watch.hamcrest match assert.assert that. Assert that. Okay, assert that is a static class which is coming from matcher assert. Then that assert that method accept actual values, first argument. The second argument is a expected value. In the JUnit test, the JUnit 5 test case method, we have seen differently, right? Expected value is a first argument, actual value is a, sorry. Yeah, expected value is a first argument, actual is a second argument. The Hamcrest test is opposite of that. So I am passing the actual value. I am checking here that actual value must be in 3, as size 3. If it is, if the data list having the size is 3, then this test case will pass. Then assert that the data list should contain Ravi and Kesavan. Ravi and Kesavan. If it is Ravi and Kesavan exist in the data list, this condition pass, this assert will pass. The data list contains any order. I am checking only the value of the data list. I don't care about order of the list. Here Suresh, Kesav and Ravi is the order, but here I am checking that value in different order, Ravi, Suresh and Kesav. So this particular method don't care about the order of the data. It's check the only value of the data list. Then assert numbers. Assert that numbers I'm passing, numbers a list, inside the list it has some number value. Okay, that number should less than 10. If all number less than 10, I'm saying this particular test case is pass. When you notice here, I'm using only assert that. In a JUnit test API, I'm using different method for different kind of check. For example, assert not null, assert equals, then assert false, assert throws, then there are many methods available, assert timeout, there are many methods available. For each assertion, it has a different assert method, but in the case of Hamcrest, we are using only one assert that method. That using that method, we can check actual value with the expected value. When you use the expected value, we have to use some static method which is coming from Hamcrest. So these are static method, this checking the expected value. Okay. So like that, there are many values available, sorry, many methods available, all are self-explanatory. Okay. Let me run this test case. It's passed. Now I'll going to use different method here. Contains in relative order. Contains in relative order. So this method check value of the list as well as order of the list. For this order is different, this order is different. Values we both are equal, but the order is different, right? So this will fail here because order is not expected. Okay, whatever actual order is available, that actual order I'm not expecting that actual order. I'm expecting different order here. So it will get failure. See, it's giving the error. See, I am expecting Ravi Suresh Kesavan, but Suresh is phone. The first item is Suresh is phone. So while checking first item itself, it's failed. So it's giving the error. It's giving very clear error. So this is the way of testing the list object using AmpQuest. There are many private methods available. You can verify that. So there are many private methods, static methods, right? Each one using for different purpose. You can practice that. All are self-explanatory. Okay. Second method, I'm checking string. These are also very simple. I'm checking is empty string. Assert that is empty string. So here I'm passing empty value. So this test case get passed. Here I'm checking this string contains a value bold. Definitely this assertion also gets passed. So it's passed. Okay. Then check number. I want to check numbers. Here I'm saying that assert that 10 greater than expected value. I'm checking 10 greater than expected value. Actually say 10. I'm expecting greater than 7. Yeah, 10 is a greater than 7. It's pass. Then 10 less than 33. Yeah, this is also pass. It passed. Well, coming back to this particular method. Why this init method? Why this init method annotated with at before each? While testing each test cases, I want to prepare some data. I want to prepare some data. Okay, I want to prepare some data. So I want to prepare that data here. Then I want to use the data to test some of the test cases. So for that purpose only we are using this init method. This method name anything, you can keep any name as you wish, but that method must annotate it with at before each. If you annotate it with at before each, this method execute whenever you test any method. Whenever you test any test case method, before executing that test case method, this method execute first. Now I'll show one example here. This we already tested, this method is working fine. Now I want to substitute this value with a variable. Okay. Int number equal to 0 MC. Int number equal to 0 MC. Then I am checking it. I need to replace with that variable here. Number. So it's failed. Right, it's a failed. The first test case itself is failed because I'm passing number value as a zero. Right, I'm initializing with a zero. The number value initialized with a zero value. So I want to give some valid value. I want to give some valid value to this number before executing this test case. I want to give some valid value. Okay, for that we can use this init. Now the test case get passed. Why? Because here I've declared number variable. That number variable initialized with a zero. Then inside a init method, which is annotated with at before each, inside this method body, I am assigning a new value called 10. When this method execute, whenever execute this method, first this method get execute, assign 10 value to number, then this method get execute. The number value having a 10, right? 10 is a greater than 7, so this test case is pass. The number value 10, right? 10 is lesser than 33, so this test case also pass.
So whenever you want to prepare some data before executing particular test cases, that time you can use this init method. Use this method. That method must annotate it with R before each. This init method can be, this init name can be anything. Okay, this name can be anything, but that method must annotate it with R before each. Okay. The final test case is map test. Map test. Okay. After test, I am saying some map test. Here I am initializing one array variable. Initializing one array variable. Sorry, map variable. Here I am initializing one map variable, hash map variable. Then I am adding two data here, India and USA. The value is a respective country code. I am saying here assert that I am passing that map value. I am checking ASCII. Key is India and USA, right? I am checking if it is key contains India, then the test case should pass. It's containing, right? So this particular test condition pass. Then assert that countries, I am checking hash entry. Hash entry meaning I want to check both key and value. Okay, I am checking key and value. USA and the value is a plus. If this particular entry is available in this hash map, I want to pass this case. It is available, right? So this particular part also get executed. This particular assert that also get passed. Let me execute that. So this is Amcrest API is a cakewalk, right? Just we have to study all the methods. Whenever you need any method in your project, you can just use it. That's it. Okay. The next one is we're going to talk about not JSON assert. We're going to check assert J. We're going to check assert J. Assert J a little bit easy when compared to Amcrest. We'll go to see in part of the next video. Okay, next video I'll try to cover AssertJ and JSON path and JSON assert. Okay. Until then, bye bye from Suresh. Still not subscribe this channel? Please subscribe it. Share this video to your friend circle. Click bell icon for regular updates. Thanks for watching this full video.